Lifeboats et prosjekt med tre skulpturer som skal bli funksjonelle skip og skal ut og seile på Europas floder og kanaler. Det består av tre skulpturer. Mitt skip ladet med lengsel, den unge, med en skattekiste inneni som skal samle inn brev om håp, drømme, lengsler. Mitt skip ladet med Liv, den gravide, som skal ha portretter, selvportretter av barn og unge inni. Og mitt skip ladet med minner, den aldrende, som skal ha symbolske gallionsfigurer, portretter av kvinner over 70, som har det til felles at de har bodd I forskjellige kulturer og kommer fra forskjellige kulturer. I den lille filmen så følger vi tilblivelsen av Mitt skip ladet med liv, den gravide. Og det viser prosessen som jo den samme I alle tre, bortsett fra det skulpturelle. For at skulpturene skal kunne seile, så har jeg jo vært I et intenst samarbeid med en skipsingeniør som har laget tegningene som gjør at skipet kan CE-sertifiseres og fullt funksjonelt. Etter at skipsingeniøren kommet med tegningene I full målestokk av spanterne til skipet, så sveises alle de 5 mm armeringsstengene sammen, horisontalt og vertikalt, og med 5 cm imellom. Over dekk skjærer vi spanterne ut I tre. Også skjærer jeg ut hodet og bryster og føtter og alt dette her I flamingo. For å ha full kunstnerisk kontroll. Og etterpå fjerner vi både flamingoen og ribbenene som armeringsjernet blitt sveiset omkring. Når hele figuren står eterisk I armeringsnettet, så legger vi på 7 lag med kyllingnett. 4 på utsiden og 3 på innsiden. Som bindes igjen sammen med 5 cm imellom, så det står virkelig stramt som en hud. Når skulpturskipet står klart til å støpes, så inviterer vi til fest. Til virkelig en arbeidsfest som varer over 3-4 døgn. Vi har altså vært rundt 150 mennesker som har kommet fra rundt 17-18 forskjellige kulturer. Som har arbeidet og spist og festet, men først og fremst arbeidet helt vilt godt sammen. Og I løpet av de dagene blir skulpturskipet helt konkret fysisk. Betongen presses gjennom 7 lag med kyllingnett med en person utenfor og en person innenfor som virkelig skal samarbeide for at det ikke kommer luft I betongen. Det man kan si networking.
Hipp, hipp!
Når støpefesten ferdig, så jo skulpturen der helt fysisk, men det veldig mye tilbake av finmodellering, finjustering, detaljer. Så det jo det flere måneders arbeid tilbake. Nå står vi i Tyskland, i Derenburg, hvor Peter Kuschinke, som har lavet øynene til den første av Lifeboats mitt skib ladet med lengsel, holder på å lage øynene til mitt skib ladet med liv. I dag det den store uttagningen av mitt skib ladet med liv. Og jeg har jo arbeidet på det i 2 år, og den dagen her har jeg jo ventet veldig på.
Men det også bredt med den, jo.
Kom da!
I dag skal mitt skib ladet med liv i vannet for aller første gang. Ja, nå jeg spent, altså.
Sculptures afloat and heading into port. The lifeboat is one of the highlights of the cultural program of the Danish city of Aarhus, which this year is one of the 2 European capitals of culture. The 3 12-meter-long floating sculptures arrived in Denmark's second largest city last October and are now the object of an exhibition at the Women's Museum. The figures are preliminary works for the project entitled My Ship is Loaded with Memories, which features 3 lifeboats dedicated to women. There are 18 figureheads, each portraying a real-life woman who has roots in different cultures. The sculptures also share a common thread, age.
I wanted to really emphasize that we are all in the same boat, whatever place we're coming from, and that the story of women, here they are all, they have in common that they're all past 70 years of age, and they come from different cultures and have related to other cultures than their own in different ways.
The 18 women immortalized in Benthe Norheims' work have roots in 27 different nations. While some move for love, others were forced to leave their homeland due to conflict.
Quite a few of them have settled because of they actually represent 8 different wars, and they have all survived the wars and believe in the future and in peace. So I think it's a very important story, or important stories to tell. By bringing all these women's stories that are about love and suffering and a lot of similarities, even though they're so different, that will, you know, also teach us or give us some of the same hope that I think in a way they represent.
While these sculptures are set to be beached and exhibited at the Women's Museum until April, there are plans to take the real lifeboats back out on the water soon. Next expected destination, Germany, and then the Netherlands later this year.
An unusual convoy has arrived in the Norwegian city of Stavanger, European co-capital of culture along with Liverpool. Four sculptures of women protruding from caravans, courtesy of Norwegian artist Marit Benthe Norheim. She's been working on this project since late 2006. I got the idea while surfing on the internet. I saw these old caravans and I imagined many different kinds of women associated with them. I thought of different body shapes related to different kinds of personalities. Each figure is carved in polyurethane and coated in a skin of fiberglass and resin. This one is the Virgin Mary, and the caravan is called the Protector. The image is associated to an old medieval picture of the Virgin as she offers her breast to Christ on Judgment Day. So she's protecting these people under her cloak. And then there's the bride, wearing a large wedding veil, and also shows an erotic element carried by the couple in front of her dress. The refugee and the camping mama complete the installation, which will be touring Norway's Rogaland region until the end of the year.
Welcome to my wonderful studio. I want to take you through the studio and up to my storage space and then down again here where I'll tell you what I'm working on at the moment. Here, my beautiful little pink balcony that we just made, wonderful place to sit and draw and to be sociable. And here, we're in the middle of the lifeboats models for my ship is loaded with memories that were shown on the Women's Museum in Aarhus and you saw on the video from Euronews. This room is beautiful in the way that I'm able to collect all the various works from different periods of my production when they come back from exhibitions. Sometimes it's very full, sometimes it's not so full. And here we can go past the figureheads for lifeboats. Here, the shepherdesses or the tourists that have been made in London while I was a student, when I was living in London, where I was a student in 1984 at the Royal Academy of Art. So they are from my 12 years in London period. This is one of the one-to-one models for one of the lifeboats. And again, models in various scales of lifeboats. This is also very early work from my period in London, 12 Sisters of Light, which I made for my final year show at the Royal Academy of Arts. I remember it was very important for me to make them in a scale that made me feel very small in the midst of them. Here I am in the middle of my laboratory. Really, this is where everything is becoming chemistry. I have an archive here of different people in my life, people who are here, people who are dead, and very, very personal memories from various parts of my life, which is what I'm digging into at the moment. And I think I would like to talk about what I'm doing at the moment. You can see this figurehead. It's a person who, 23 years old, died from having been ill since he was 8. Very, very heavy disease. His parents and his younger brother asked me to make a homage to him. It's going to go on that big house you can see in the background. And I was very touched and also very affected by the family's need and wish to make their vulnerability visible and to lift their life struggle, but also their incredible joy over the young guy, his life, and their pain and suffering at the same time. That mix of very strong feelings. I think it really did something to me in the process where I have been a mother of a young woman who has been ill since she was 14 after a tick bite, where I actually call her heroine of hope because she's had to struggle so much in her life and she's always been able to give us and everyone around her hope that she will manage and grow and flow. So here you can see I've been working on her as a mermaid, because to be able to survive on many levels, she has used the imagery of the mermaid as an image of being able to come up to the surface every time where she's down on under and below water surface. She's been floating, this one's been floating on the river for, or the fjord for 4 months last summer with a solar light in her arms, looking into the shore where this guy has been crying skeletons, crying for the world and dreaming, longing for what is maybe not so easy to not so easy to understand what we're working with as artists, what is between the lines that you can't really touch upon, but you can try to try to make a mark somehow, scratch the surface of something that we might be able to dive deeper into. And this is also the mermaid. The mermaid that is based upon a song that Tonya, my daughter, is a composer. And she has made a very beautiful song around her struggle, which this one has been made from her title, Mermaids Don't Cry, and No One Asks Why. It's a very special time to be an artist, I think, during these corona times. And with these very heavy personal stories that I have just told a little bit about, I decided that I wanted to go into using an overall title called Homage to Vulnerability. And I think really the vulnerability is something that everyone shares. Some people have more conditions, situations in their or in our lives than other people, but we will for sure, all of us, touch upon the vulnerabilities in various shape and form during our lives. And I decided to go into that, as in the corona times people have been saying, the politicians have been saying, now we have to really try to take care of the vulnerable, of the sick, the old people, chronic illness have been touched upon for more or less the first time in public space. And I decided that I wanted to make portraits like in lifeboats as a continuation of what happened during the lifeboats, portraits of the old women that I was talking about in the video from Euronews. Here, if you come, I can show them. Here's a whole series of small portraits that are on their way to develop into this project of homage to the vulnerability, or to not to the vulnerable, but to vulnerability. The first one is a figure that is an outsider artist who's dead, but I was part of making a very
Yeah, it's part of getting his work onto an exhibition at the art museum and making a book about him. He had a very heavy life, but managed to get his life fulfillment during the last few years. He died at 85 years old. And here, these are a couple of very good friends of ours who were part of working in the self-owned institutions for managing lifeboats. And they, together with two other people, drowned in Greenland when they went on a holiday there in 2014, which was a very, very huge loss in all possible ways. But they managed to go together, and they had great love for each other. This is Eric and his Sunny Road. He's got on his chest the portrait or holding his wife, Solveig Sunny Road, who is very ill with cancer at the moment and won't live that much longer. He is 68 and has been a psychiatric patient his whole life. But when I was at the Royal Academy, I made a book about him and his very, very strong and insightful writings and drawings. And now I want to, in 2 years when he's 70, I'm going to make a homage to him where his work will be exhibited and there will be a book with his drawings and his writings published together with music from Tonje, who is a composer and his goddaughter. This one is just called Prayer and is, I think, a portrait of my mother and her having to hold my father, who died a year ago and was very ill the last few years of his life. Here you can see my wonderful German teacher. He was a really remarkable teacher, came from a very heavy background where his brother committed suicide, his sister was in psychiatric hospital his whole life, and he said he managed because he was taken care of by an aunt, and the only thing he wanted was to lift young people and show them the joy of life. He unfortunately fell out of the window and broke his neck only also a year ago. This is a little portrait of my father. I call it Portrait of My Dad as a Cowboy and Indian. The feathers are my mom and us three daughters. And yeah, Portrait of My Father as a Cowboy and Indian and Melting Down. So he was really some kind of chief. He was a real, I would say, an Indian chief in his way. We were three daughters, and it's hard to see him melting down with dementia, as quite a few old people do. Here,
Our youngest daughter, who is a dancer, physical theater person, she's always, always moving. And she has had to deal with a lot of being the daughter of two artists and what that means economically and time-wise and everything, and a sister who's been very ill. But she is a very, very compassionate and very artistically driven also. And here, the last one of this first series. I have lots of more ideas for these ones, but this is Tonya as a tree of life, our oldest daughter, who that came from a dream where I saw her getting into a boat, falling, or I thought she was drowning, but I could see that she was driving full speed in a labyrinth underneath the water, and she managed to get out of all the dangers and out of the sea and melting in together with a tree of life when she came out of the water. And this is just a very small, short presentation of these people that I think are, very special people, because they've managed to survive and live with a lot of passion, even though life has given them a lot of blows. This is really that series. But to end off this whole presentation, I want to show something that kind of came to life again, which also is connected with the vulnerabilities, with the protection. I've been working with symbols that are very close to symbols that are easy to enter in all cultures, whether you're into art or not. And angels are part of those, like figureheads or angels that I made when I was visiting London in 2000. You saw from the film, but now they have been reawakened and used in Dresden as a commemoration for the bombing of Dresden 75 years ago, where they've been wheeling around into demonstrations of anti-fascists meeting very strong neo-Nazism and Nazism in, together with the police. So hundreds of thousands of people and police, where they became really tools of peace. They brought smile and less aggression into the whole situation. And in a way, they really were vulnerable in their beings, and they were protecting and protected. And they got a special permission to move around in the corona, with the corona masks in Dresden in May.